Hello. Getting set up here, wait for people to pop in as we get going here today. Talking a little bit about compliance and sales. Not a sexy topic, but it's mostly in regards to digital marketing and how, essentially I'm speaking a lot to insurance professionals, all my peeps over at Agency Nation. And the insurance professionals, the independent agents, and financial advisors, stuff like that. So the crux of what we're going to talk about today came out of a conversation that originated on Snapchat. So if you guys aren't on Snapchat, that's not really the point. If you're not and you're getting on there, or you are and you want to connect with me, I am Ryan M. Hanley. So all one word, Ryan M as in Michael Hanley, on Snapchat. Connect with me there, because really today, with how busy I am, with all the different things that I'm doing, speaking, and I'm not saying that to be braggadocious, just incredibly busy, running all over, two tiny little kids. The easiest way to connect with me is Snapchat. So this is actually what happened. I had an insurance agent send me a snap, and I'll show it to you guys. Basically, he had a question screen here, and this was his question. Essentially, he had a couple questions, and then he said this: "I was pissed off because my company put in," and he meant to say, "put a stop to me as they were afraid I would conquer." I love that. Basically, saying compliance in the name of compliance, and I responded, "Compliance is a code word." Now, granted, a little bit of that is my style, right? Like, obviously, I've had to deal with compliance in my life. I've had to deal with a lot of different things, and my thought process tends to be, I see this as just another stepping stone in getting to where we want to be, which is being able to share our story and our message and connect with people who potentially become their customers or referral partners or center of influence and all that really good stuff. So, but what I hear all the time, and again, I mean, last year I did 28 speaking engagements, right? Like, probably three quarters of which were in the insurance industry. So, definitely an industry that has to deal with compliance issues. And, I've definitely had this question come up. And what I get all the time is, what about errors and omissions? Or if they have a financial component to their business, I get, we have to deal with our licenses, and we don't want to lose our ability to sell securities, and the SEC is always very highly regulating us, and there's all kinds of compliance issues with that. And usually, especially if you're dealing with a company that has a financial advising arm, as the Murray Group did, that's my former agency, then you're going to have a big compliance department. And what happens a lot of times is that compliance department doesn't just stop at the securities. They roll into the property casualty or any other services that you provide for your business. They'll roll into those as well. And it can become a huge, huge obstacle for marketers and for salespeople, right? Because now every communication that you want to put out into the world becomes something that compliance gets a say in whether or not that goes out the door. Have you guys dealt with this? If any of you guys have dealt with this, let me know. And as we go, you can share your experiences in the comments. So I had to deal with this. We had a financial arm. We had to deal with the E&O. And back in 2009, when I was first starting to really get into digital marketing in my agency, there was all these things, and E&O attorneys. So in the insurance world, and any of my independent agent friends that are watching this know, attorneys who talk about errors and omissions coverage. So E&O. So this is specific to property and casualty. If you're a financial advisor in another industry, just bear with this. There's a point to this. So there's these attorneys, and there's basically like a circuit, and they roll through every state, and they basically hold these little meetings, and you get continuing education credit for them, and they essentially stand up in front of the audience. And I call it fear mongering. They tell you all the things that you can't do, or otherwise the government is going to come crashing down on your agency and take away all your licenses, and your business will be over. And granted, there are a lot of things that you could do that are really stupid that could, and for good reason, you could lose your license. One of those things is not marketing your business on social media. So in 2009, 2010, when I first started really heavily marketing the Murray Group, my family's independent insurance agency, online, I spent a lot of time on the phone with both the Department of Insurance and the IABNY, the Independent Insurance Agents and Brokers of New York, which is the state association, or one of the state associations for independent insurance agents, talking about, what were the exposures? What do we have to think about from a compliance standpoint? What could we say we couldn't? And let me boil this all the way down for you. And I'm going to get to financial advisors in a second because that's a different side of the house, different issues. But just from an independent property casualty and most of the life products, as long as they don't involve investments, from so unless you have a variable annuity or a variable life policy, so taking those things out, just standard life insurance and property casualty insurance products. As long as you don't say something stupid or make a guarantee, or let me say it a different way. You can say something stupid. As long as you don't make a guarantee or share someone's private information, it's almost impossible for them to take away your license. There has actually never been an adjudicated case in which a property casualty insurance agent has had his license or her license taken away because of something that was said on social media. There hasn't been. Now, there have been a few claims. They've never actually been, no one has actually ever had their license taken away. No one's ever actually been found guilty, and had any real repercussions happen to them. So when I stand up in front of an audience and I talk about blogging or using Facebook or ads or whatever, to help capture your audience's attention, and someone says, "Well, Ryan, what about E&O?" I think in 2016, we can laugh at that person a little bit because that is just an excuse. It is literally just the resistance inside us saying, "Oh, I really don't want to do this, so I'm going to use this as a reason." Again, I'm talking property casualty. I'm not talking about financial advice. That's a whole other world. We're going to get to that in a second. So, from a property casualty and non-variable life products side of the business, that side of the house, it is incredibly difficult for you to lose your license or even really be penalized. Now, you can say stupid things. It can hurt your brand. It can hurt your sales. Absolutely. You want to go off on a Trump rant or a Hillary rant or get into religion, God forbid, talk about parenting, all these other things. That's your prerogative, and I wouldn't advise you to go into any of those topics. But you can do those things. You can compare companies. You can do a Travelers versus Hartford. You can compare policies. You can do all that stuff. As long as you don't guarantee things, like saying if you have a certain level of coverage, you guarantee they'll be covered, right? So it would be stupid, and you should be penalized if you were to say, if you purchase $100,000 in at-fault liability on your auto policy, you're covered, you're good. That's a stupid thing to say, and you should be penalized for that because what you're essentially doing is creating a guarantee situation. And as any reasonable human being knows, $100,000 could be enough or it could not be enough. It's completely dependent on the situation, and we should never guarantee anything. You can talk in generalities. So what you can say is, what we've found is the most often purchased policy from us is $100,000 in at-fault liability. What we actually recommend is $500,000. Now, there are additional layers above $500,000, but what we found is in most cases, bang for the buck, $500,000 in at-fault liability is a good place to start for your family. But what we always advise is that you sit down with either one of our consultants or whoever does your insurance to figure out if that's the right amount for you and make that determination then. In this way, what you've done is said, this is my recommendation, but I am not guaranteeing in any way, nor am I giving you specific advice. And you can even put a little disclaimer at the bottom of your blog post that says, this is not specific advice. It is used for informational purposes only. Absolutely, you can do that. I did that for a little while, and then I did some more reading and basically found that it doesn't really matter. But if that makes you feel comfortable, at the bottom, maybe in italics, you can put a little note that just says, this is for informational purposes only. This is not a recommendation of coverage. You must talk to a licensed advisor for recommendations, blah, blah, blah. And then from a property casualty side of the house, you have done a very good job of setting yourself up by not sharing any personal information. So don't put, I saved this guy $100 because his birthday was, March 17th of 20, of, 1987. And I saved him, that would be stupid. That's a stupid thing to do. So, no personal information, no guarantees on the property casualty side. You're in a pretty good place. Now, again, I'm not going to guarantee that you'll never, that you'll never be sued, but I have found, yes, I have read, trust me, I'm lying. And in just in general, it's unless you are willing to put yourself in a position, unless you're willing to put yourself in that position, guaranteeing anything, I just don't think is a really smart move. There's so much gray area in every industry. There are very strong recommendations that you can make, and I have made the recommendation 1,000 times on when I was in the insurance marketing side of my life, where I would say things like, "I recommend this, anyone over the age of 20 who owns anything, any property at all, have $500,000 in at-fault liability. That's my recommendation as a minimum." But I would never guarantee you that that was enough, ever. And that is where we catch ourselves, is when we say, if you do this, that's enough. That's enough. You'll be set. You'll be all set. That type of language gets you in trouble, because now you're saying you're by purchasing this specific thing, you're fine. You can forget it and remove the liability from yourself, and then that's just not a place you want to put yourself in. So you can make recommendations, but never make guarantees, and never share someone's personal information. Otherwise, from an E&O standpoint and from a compliance standpoint, there's not that much to worry about from a property casualty side. And as Nathan Bunty shared in that post that I shared earlier, he commented and he said, from a property casualty side, there's not a whole lot to worry about, but from a financial advising side, there's a ton of compliance. So for sales and marketers who work with financial products, okay, there's a completely different side to this. So let's talk a little bit about that. You now have a incredibly active and strong governmental body, the Securities Exchange Commission, now regulating everything you say. And a lot of this has to do with bait and switch tactics and all kinds of stuff, which, as much as these from a marketer standpoint are frustrating, from a consumer standpoint, and some of the things that have been done in the financial industry with, telephone banks and, the Wolf of Wall Street and Boiler Room and all that kind of stuff, these are probably well-placed regulations. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't market our business. It doesn't mean that we can't share our expertise. It does not mean that. But what it does mean is we do have to deal with compliance in this standpoint. Now, when I posted compliance is a code word for scared, what I meant was not that compliance was stupid and we should just be like a gunslinger saying, screw compliance, I'm going to go out and say whatever I want and do whatever I want to generate business. That, again, that would be crazy. That's not what I'm advocating here. What I'm advocating is that we cannot say that just because we have to go through a compliance process that we can't market our business. And I've had many, many financial advisors come up and say this to me, Ryan, to get a one pager through takes 2 weeks, and compliance picks it apart. Okay, take the 2 weeks. Understand, if you want to get a blog post out, it might take 3 weeks to get through compliance, and there's certain words you can and can't use. Okay, that's completely fine. Understand that you need to be working out 3 weeks. Understand that if there's things coming up, if there's holidays coming up, if there's things you want to work around, if there's events, if you have a networking event coming up, if you have a webinar coming up, whatever it is that you're trying to market around, just understand that if compliance takes 3 weeks, you need to work within a 3 week buffer. That you just need to plan that far out, because compliance is not an excuse for not marketing your business. Now, what can you do? Again, you are even more regulated on the guarantees thing. When you're a financial advisor, you're dealing with any kind of financial products. This includes variable life, variable annuities, anything like that. You have an incredibly, incredibly fine line that you can walk in terms of your language, and absolutely, positively stay away from anything that even resembles a guarantee. I can't stress this enough. This is like, now there's a lot of other things you can't say either, but guarantees on a financial space, oh my gosh, that is where people get caught all the time, is they even insinuations. And here's another big one. Never insinuate that you'll get a guaranteed return. Never insinuate that that somehow by working with you there'll be any kind of reduced commission. You can't trade commission for business there, or fees or any of that stuff. I mean, what you can do is answer, and this is where I would go with this, answer very specific questions that people can readily find online or in other places. Just answer them in your voice for the particular target market and demographic you're looking for the intent of where that person is. So where is that person in the buying process? Just because you have to go through compliance doesn't mean that you can't work within they ask, you answer, that you can't do intent-based marketing, that you can't be telling your story online. Again, not everything has to talk about the financial products. You can be much more cavalier. Yes, yeah, Drew, so that's what I'm saying. And I apologize for the Periscope pause there. But yeah, basically what I'm saying is every piece of content that comes out of your office when you're dealing with financial products. This isn't property casualty insurance. This is financial products, mutual funds, stocks, variable annuities, variable life, retirement funds. Anytime you're dealing with that kind of stuff, every Facebook post, every tweet, you're potentially liable for. So you need to be very, very, very careful with what you're doing. That doesn't mean you can't do it. And that's what I'm trying to get to here is that, you don't need to just so you have to take some different tactics. You can't just look at this from a, I'm going to talk about the fact that I have Fidelity in my shop and here's what Fidelity offers. Talk more about that person's life and you have to look at it more on the intent. Where are they in their life? What things are they thinking about? Are there other things you can talk about that establish you as a professional that draw them in other than the topics that are so highly regulated? And this is how you get around compliance. So I just wanted to bring, I wanted to do a quick show here. Unless you guys have questions, which Drew, that was a great question. If you have any more questions, please put them in. I wanted to talk about this topic because I shared this Snapchat that I had, and I got some really great feedback. One of my buddies who works in the marketing space had some really strong words. But again, I think they thought I was saying you should blow past compliance. That would be ludicrous. That's not what I was advocating. What I was advocating is that we can't use compliance as a crutch to not do what we need to do to grow our business. And we have to be careful, we have to be smart, but that doesn't mean that we can't get our story out into the world, we can't answer client questions, we can't put our message in front of people in the place that they're looking to find it. Doesn't mean we can't use Facebook, it just means that we have to be a little more understanding. And if you have a 3 week lag on compliance, just build out 3 weeks. Take 1 day out of your work week. Take 1 day, get 3 weeks out in content so you have that nice buffer so you're never like showing up and not having anything to write about. You know, as the next week hits, the content you put in 3 weeks ago is rolling out of compliance and now you can use it this week. You know, get that kind of process going and just work within that framework and understand that every one of your competitors is dealing with compliance. Every single one of your competitors. You can either do what they're doing and just continue to be kind of part of the pack, or you can find ways to work within the framework of the compliance issues that financial advising and the financial industry faces and figure out how to separate yourself. And if you have any more questions on that, obviously you can always hit me up, Ryan at ryanhanley.com or Ryan.Hanley@trustedchoice.com. If you work in the insurance space, that's the best way to get a hold of me via email. And always Snapchat for anyone. And just, you know, I like Snapchat, Ryan M. Hanley, because it's super quick. You can bang me with a quick video or message, and I can get back at you just about anywhere, no matter what I'm doing. And I'm always happy to do that. So, you know, I'm answering probably at this point a dozen to two dozen questions a day. Content digital related on Snapchat. It's a lot of fun and happy to do it. So hopefully you guys will connect with me. I hope you enjoyed this. If you have any follow-up questions on compliance, always, like I said, ping me, ryan@ryanhanley.com or ryan.hanley@trustedchoice.com. And look forward to catching you guys on the flip. I'm out of here.